Welcome to the sixth Sunday of Easter. Join me in the greeting. Bless the Lord, O people, sing. Let the sound of praise ring out. Come and hear what the Lord has done, the Lord who has made everything. Let us sing together the song, Easter People, Raise Your Voices.
Shall we stand?
Easter people, raise your voices, sounds of heaven and earth should ring. Christ has brought us heaven's choices, heavenly music let it ring. Alleluia, alleluia, Easter people, let us sing. Death can no more stop us from our pressing here below. For our Lord empowers us to triumph over every foe. Alleluia, alleluia, on to victory now we go. Is Easter with its resurrection song. When in trouble, move the faster to our God who rights the wrong. Alleluia, alleluia, see the power of heavenly throng.
Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, our helper and advocate. Open our hearts and minds today. Entice us with your presence. Spark us with the word of life, a message that we may share with others as we seek to live Christ's love in the world. All this we ask in the name of God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us. Amen. A reading from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 27. The word of God for us, follow along as I read. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now what you worship is something unknown. I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all people life and breath and everything else. From one person he made every nation, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that all would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us." This is God's word. Let us respond first of all in our silence. Amen. Searching for the God who is near. In 2010, Leona and I joined with some folks from the East German Annual Conference and our annual conference here in Western Pennsylvania, and we went together on a mission trip to the Dominican Republic with the least of these ministries. Before we went, the folks, the team that was from the U.S., we gathered together and we prepared ourselves and who was going to bring what and what we would be doing and everything. And so we would also have prayer time together. And I heard a phrase being used during those meetings that didn't really sit well with me. And that phrase was, "We're going to take Jesus to them. We're going to take Jesus to them." And I'm reminded that, you know, when we had the bicentennial of Methodism, that they had that the painting Cokesbury was selling of John Wesley ushering or sending forth the folks to the colonies, and the name was called "Give Them Christ" or "Send Them Christ" or something to that effect. You know, when I hear that, I think it's rather presumptuous of a thing to say. We're going to take Christ to them. And you know, I enjoy words. Words mean something. And so I try to dissect them. I try to figure out what people really mean by what they say and what are some of the ramifications of that phrase. Take or bring Christ to them. You know, some of the ramifications means he's not already there. And that we are the ones who have Jesus. And I think that's kind of pretentious of us to think that God is only working within us as though we're the only ones with the message. That God isn't in the Dominican Republic. And so I didn't quite like that phrase. I was doing some other stuff as well, some other reading, and I went on the mission trip to help. But I had like a, you know, there was another thing that I wanted to see, check out, that I was wanted to perhaps experience, that I wanted to research, and that was where Jesus already was. Where was Jesus in the Dominican Republic? I went not to bring Jesus to them, I went to find him. I went to see what Jesus was doing in the Dominican Republic and how perhaps I might become a part of that, or that what he, you know, that the Jesus in the Dominican Republic might minister to me as well as I ministered with these folks. That's kind of a thing that Paul is doing here in Athens. Now, Paul is brought before, or he finds himself, we don't know if he, you know, I don't think they arrested Paul and said, "You have to talk to these people about your religion, about your faith, before you can continue." I don't think it was that. This was a group of people, and they were known as the Areopagus. It was both the people and the place. And these were people that were responsible for talking to other folks about philosophy, religion, spiritual matters. And they had heard that there was a new teaching going on in Athens that Paul was talking about. And so they wanted to find out more about it. Now, Athens was a very religious city. There were temples and there were altars and there were places for all sorts of deities. And so, you know, they had kind of dual names. They had the old Greek names like Ares, and that's where, you know, Areopagus is Ares, and the other part of that word meant rock or hill. And so it was originally known as Ares Hill, and then when the Romans got there, Ares turns into Mars. They give him that name, and it's now Mars Hill. And so it's the location and the people. And so Paul looks at all of the ways that they're worshiping all of these deities, and he sees this altar, and it's inscribed "to the unknown God." And it seems kind of goofy that you're going to worship a God that you don't really know. But that's not what they were doing. You see, part of the way that they worshiped was whenever they were blessed by something, they offered their sacrifices on the different altars to the different deities. And so if you just had a successful crop, you would worship at the deity that was, you know, the deity of the harvest, or the deity of the commerce if you just made a good business deal, or if you found out that, you know, you and your wife were now expecting, perhaps you would, out of gratitude, offer an offering, make an offering on the altar to the deity of fertility. And so they were thanking the gods. They were petitioning as well and trying to gain information, but they were also thanking the deities. And so this place, this altar to the unknown god, is where the folks would go and offer give their offerings because they didn't know who did it. And so they didn't know which one of the many deities it was to thank. And so they would say, "Here it is. Thank you. I don't know who you are or which one of you did it, but thanks anyhow." And so, you know, that was their experience. Now, what I love about this is Paul understands that God is already in this city, and that Paul uses this altar to the unknown god as a branching off point, or as a point of intersection, to talk about ways in which they have indeed been worshiping a god who was very close to them and they didn't know it all along. And so he begins to tell them about God, and he says, you know, that this God that you've been giving alms to, that you've been thanking, doesn't dwell in a temple made with hands, and he's not served by human beings, but rather it is God who seeks to give us breath and life and everything else. It is this God who has put us in our places, who've determined the times and the places where we should live. And then he says, God did this so that all would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not very far from each one of us. He's saying to these folks, you know, you're already doing it. You're almost there. Let me give you the name. Let me describe your experience. Let me tell you what you've been going on so that you can name it and own it. You see, I went to the Dominican Republic not to bring Jesus, but to find Jesus. I went to find that God who is not far from each one of us. I went to see where God has been working and will continue to work in the Dominican Republic. And so I found that, you know, Jesus had already been there. There were folks that were worshiping Jesus in churches that were older than I was. So he had been there a lot longer than before I showed up and before any other folks on the mission team showed up. But I remember one particular experience where I met Jesus. I found him in a work camp. The work camps are called Betes. And the work camps are like a village. Just all kinds of shacks, and that's what they are, shacks, that people have put together with whatever they can find to build. And it seems like they found a lot of, perhaps some bamboo to make the frames, and then they would cut parts of palm trees and use those as siding. And some were able to find the corrugated roofing material and use that. Others thatched the palm branches together. Most of them lived on a dirt floor. And they were maybe, you know, 8x8 shacks. Some had electricity, and they brought the electricity in by finding bits and pieces of wire, and they would twist them together, and they would hook on out by the road to the main power line, and they would just keep adding to it, and they would bring it into the Bate. The Bates were folks that originally came from Haiti seeking work in the sugarcane fields. And then when that kind of dried up, or they weren't doing that much anymore, Haiti didn't want them back, and the Dominican Republic didn't want them. And so there are people living there without a country, without aid, without, you know, the government helping them out. And I ran into Jesus, an old man, leaning against the palm tree siding of his neighbor's shack. Old man, wrinkled. There's a lot of dirt, a lot of dust, a lot of mud. And when I looked at him sitting there, I couldn't tell where the dust and the dirt ended and the man began. He just seemed to meld into the mess. And I looked into his eyes, and they were those that darkish white ivory eyes, glazed over with cataracts, that he really wasn't able to see clearly the miracle that was happening in front of him. And this is what was happening in front of him. That the folks in our group and some of the other folks that were hired from the Dominican Republic, we were working together and we were moving sand and concrete mix and mixing it up and putting a cement floor in this man's house so that he no longer had to sleep in the mud, the dust, and the dirt. Just a little bit more of a sanitary way of living for him in his aged state. I sat down next to him, and we really couldn't communicate. We didn't know each other's language, and I just smiled and looked into his eyes and shook my head. And I patted his hand, and I saw all of those deep wrinkles and those hands somewhat crippled with arthritis. I've seen old man's hands. I remember my father's. Later on, I reflected on this experience and I remembered what I saw. And sitting alongside of this man was a towel, and there was also a little basin of muddied water. And I understood that I had sat next to Jesus and that I had helped to make a cement floor for Jesus. Why do I say it's Jesus? He was Jesus because Jesus says, when you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. Reflecting on this, I wrote a devotional for us as we were there in the Dominican, and this is the last paragraph. This is where I saw God, who was very near. Watch this thing that is coming to pass. As Jesus waits in the dust in Bete Alta Gracia, great grace. A towel laying next to his aged brown feet alongside a plastic tub of muddy water. Watch these disciples. This time it is not Jesus, but they who carry the water bow at his feet and wash him. And when they are done, his dark brown skin shines like the sheen of a freshly finished wet cement floor in a shack, in a home, a casa, in a small work camp outside of the town of Barahona, Dominican Republic, just this side of heaven. God did this so that all would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. And my friends, I think our task is not so much to bring Jesus to people, but to help them give name to the experience of God who has already been in their midst. Their hungering and their thirsting, their desire for meaning and purpose, their desire to figure all of this out, their desire to be reassured that everything's okay. And sometimes I think we do best to search out and to name the God who is already there, who is not far from each one of us. Amen. Join me as we sing the song, Surely the Presence. Receive the benediction. Brothers and sisters, lovers of Jesus and beloved of Jesus, He is very near to us. Go and search and find. And when given the opportunity, help others. Help them to see the God who is very, very near to them. To God be the glory, the praise, and the honor. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God keep you safe and healthy. God give you a good week, and check back next week.